Oasis Audio presents Cry Like a Man by Jason Wilson. Read for you by Damany Jackson.
To every man who is tired of not being able to say he is tired. Foreword. I was relieved when I met Jason Wilson and heard his story and revelation. I clearly related well to his story, but I admit that I never knew I could be delivered from what he so eloquently refers to as emotional incarceration. The way I grew up, I couldn't help but become callous and numb. I was a young black man searching for identity in my surroundings. Little did I know who I was and would become would be later found on the inside. The most defining years of my youth were spent living in South Philadelphia in a housing project called Passyunk Homes. It was low-income housing meant primarily for women and children, but some men were allowed to live there. A few of the couples were even married. It was a very active neighborhood, and criminal behavior was at a high volume. Drug dealers and their associates occupied many of the street corners. They demanded respect from everyone and was ready to render consequence to anyone failing to demonstrate that respect. These were the only men available to teach me about manhood. The married and responsible men were around too, but somehow they remained out of my reach. I'd watch them leave the projects in the morning as I went to school and they went to work, and I'd notice them return later that afternoon while we were outside playing. They were always coming or going, never stopping or talking, never correcting or advising. They just seemed to not care as they passed by. It may have been the only way they knew how to keep themselves focused and committed. The dealers, on the other hand, were always around and ready to instruct me on how to be a man, how to gain respect and provide for my loved ones. They stressed to me the importance of having money. They said the more money I had was equal to me having more power, and that power is what people respected. I was taught that crying is a form of weakness and I should avoid it at all costs. I was made to believe it was the only way I'd survive in such an unstable and hostile environment. So when my beloved grandfather died, I didn't cry. When my friend Amanda was raped and murdered by her stepfather, I still remember the weight of that pain today. I didn't cry. When my favorite cousin Buggy was shot and killed over less than an ounce of marijuana, I refused to let the tears flow. I thought strength was measured by how well I could hold back my tears under pressure. Even at the age of 15, when I was shot by two guys on my way home to the projects, I didn't cry. 8 shots, 3 hit me at point-blank range, no tears. I turned and watched them run away, and all I could think about was how angry and betrayed I felt. I hadn't done anything to deserve this. I had never shot anyone. I wasn't a dealer. I wasn't a thief. Just an aspiring rap artist hoping to get money the legal way. Tragedy after tragedy, PTSD, and a porn addiction all before the age of 16. I never knew how to properly process my emotions. I still don't at times. However, an encounter I had with the Most High at age 20 showed me that my identity is found not in my own strength, but in His. His word has taught me that true manhood is seen in my ability to make mature decisions, live a disciplined life, and be a servant to others, instead of possessing a careless, self-serving, self-preserving mindset. Many men today who share my past experiences feel like there's no way to cope with pain and hurt other than violence, reckless living, or passivity. I believe Mr. Wilson's efforts to inspire, empower, and educate through his story will help many men feel our way through the trauma we've experienced so we can process and express our emotions in a healthy way. Ishan Burgundy, Christian hip-hop artist. Prologue. Men, we've scaled the heights, lifted and carried enormous burdens, sailed vast oceans, and have even broken free from the atmosphere that enfolds us from birth to death to fly among the stars. We mine the minerals and metals of the earth and create incredible machines that serve to propel us to our next aspiration. Yet amid all the risk and reward, the dilemmas and dangers, and the thrilling advances we've made, men have yet to conquer the most basic human ability, to cry. Want to hear something shocking? It's impossible to be strong all the time. With all the theories, credos, and misleading mantras, man up, no pain, no gain. Not to be outdone by the mother of all misguided intelligence, real men don't cry. We have been deceived into suppressing our emotions to impress others. There's simply no room for weakness. If we're struck in our hearts, our health, or our wallets, there's no room for weakness. When we vent, we're perceived as complainers. When we hurt, we're wimps. When we're tired, we're being lazy. When we fight, we're rebels. When we're discouraged, we're depressed. When we hesitate, we're double-minded, and when we cry, we're soft. With all these predetermined judgments about us, it's no wonder why so many of us fake it to make it. From childhood through early puberty, then into manhood, we're conditioned to swallow our pain, expressing little but indifference and detachment about the chaos around us. It only makes sense that internalized stress and confusion build over time, creating a force that will eventually find a release hatch. And we all know what that looks like. Self-medication, aggression, violence, until we finally hit the wall and break. And how many people do we take down with us along this destructive path of denial and pretense? Family members, girlfriends, wives, children, ourselves. I realized, after a lifetime of holding it all in, the injuries from cruelty, neglect, and the loss of so many loved ones, that men couldn't and shouldn't have to withstand the pressure they were never designed to endure alone. The barriers I had subconsciously built, brick by agonizing brick, were merely a defense that was keeping the damage inside, pushing it down deeper and deeper. I couldn't control it. I couldn't control anything. I was a prisoner of my own emotional incarceration without the slightest idea of how I got there. The key was right in front of me. I just couldn't see it. Suppressed feelings of anger and anxiety in men have reached epidemic levels, changing the landscape of society within families, schools, cities, and ultimately within prisons. And if it's not addressed now, it's simply going to kill us. It's my prayer that as you read this book and open your heart, you may see a little of your own journey within its pages, stories of trials and triumphs, enabling you to unlock the cell you've been living in for far too long. God, whom I often refer to as the Most High, has played an enormous role in releasing the inner turmoil of my past. His presence wasn't something I was aware of early on, but as I grew older, losing my way in the critical decisions that would shape my future, I struggled with his very existence. Even the name Jesus held little importance. Paintings of him cradling lambs or bouncing children on his knee seemed less than masculine, even soft. I rarely thought about his stunning bravery, willingly submitting to the brutality of evil men, even being nailed to a cross, and what it actually meant. As my relationship with the Most High developed, I began to use the Hebrew name, Yahushua, when referring to Christ, and you'll notice that name throughout this book. But many times you'll see Yah used for both the Father and the Son, as they are and will forever be one. It's personal and reflects the greatness of who they are to me. Heavenly Father, Savior, Friend. In the time I spent getting to know Yahushua, my desire to empower other men became stronger. I asked my pastor, Gregory Alexander, to teach a men's Bible study on discipleship. To my surprise, he chose to focus on David and his mighty men instead of on Yahushua and his disciples. We started in the cave of Adullam, the place where David fled for his life. After a brief discussion, The class moved on, but I didn't. Something intrigued me about this cave. The tangible result of my research is the Cave of Adulam Transformational Training Academy, CATA, under the umbrella of The Union, a nonprofit organization I launched in Detroit in 2003. As I began to identify the direct connection between male fear and transparency and the freedom that comes with being vulnerable, I created CATA's Emotional Stability Training. Martial arts and biblical principles are used to teach boys and young men how to introspectively conquer their negative emotions instead of succumbing to them. My passion and pursuit in telling my story in this book is to help boys and men find their strength to become courageously transparent about their own brokenness and to shed light on the symptoms, causes, and effects of childhood trauma and father wounds, to free them from emotional incarceration, to see their minds renewed, souls weaned, and relationships restored. Cry Like a Man is my own story. It has strong elements of racial terror because that has shaped my journey. Ultimately, it is the tale of how I came to overcome every source of anger, hatred, and self-condemnation that had kept me in an emotional prison. No matter what your age, ethnicity, or social status, you can break the cycle and escape the mental prison that keeps you confined to the limits of misconstrued masculinity. Learn to feel without fear. Accept that you're not a superhero and remove the cape. As men, our kryptonite is the grinding lifestyle that keeps us working when we need to rest, fighting when we need to seek peace, and worrying when we need to pray. As you walk through the past with me in the pages ahead, my deep desire is that you will discover the power, love, and self-control it takes to truly cry like a man. Chapter 1: The Conviction of Estes Wright. No one is born hating another person because of the color of their skin, or his background, or his religion. People must learn to hate. And if they can learn to hate, they can be taught to love, for love comes more naturally to the human heart than its opposite. Nelson Mandela, Long Walk to Freedom. Like red ink spilled on a black and white page, so black and white, the blood of Estes Wright poured out. His face disfigured from the sustained and brutal beating of 6 white men, his fiercely loyal heart pulled and stretched beyond its pain threshold, with its labored pounding growing weaker as the authorities stood over him, watching. It was 1935 when Estes lay dying in the jailhouse in Fort Pierce, Florida. A fresh cord of trauma scarring his neck squeezed a death rattle from his throat as the life drained from my grandfather. And no one did a thing to stop it. Estes Wright had the kind of charisma that was hard to miss, a blessing or a curse depending on the company. A fruit picker by trade, Estes, unlike his peers, had a dynamic personality and strong sense of self that left a lasting impression on everyone he met, but on no one more than his young, impressionable brother-in-law, James. Estes and his wife, Margaret, were in their mid-30s and expecting their 6th child. They had grown up in caring, church-going families that kept them loved and protected, if only within the safety of their homes. The couple were radical Christians, though Margaret was more religious and Estes less conforming. Her passionate relationship with Christ went well beyond weekly Sunday school and the annual homecoming potlucks. It was her devotion to God that reinforced her husband's identity in the one who created him, the one who created everyone in his own image and equally loved them. An image with no dominating color, only brilliant hues of humanity. Estes believed in the dignity and integrity of every individual, no matter how light or dark his or her skin. A dangerous ideal for a Negro in the pre-World War II Deep South. There was no questioning that Estes was fearless, at times unapologetically. It was this strength and determination.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.